Hi, so if you have ever been to a store to purchase a new laptop or to build a new PC, chances are the shopkeeper would have asked you like what the intended purpose is. Like, is it for gaming? Is it for office use? Is it for like daily use or things like that? And right after this discussion, he or she may have asked you or suggested certain specifications. Now, this is when most people lose track of the conversation, because that's when you're presented with a lot of new names and seemingly random numbers. With this video and the ones coming in the future, we kind of hope to break down these terms and numbers for the common non-tech savvy people out there. In the process, we also hope to help you make a better decision when it comes to choosing parts for your PC or you're out buying a new laptop. And before I start, I want to preface this video by saying that I am no computer guru. And the information I'm going to share with you is something I've collected over the years building PCs and from a wide variety of online and offline sources. So if you think I've made any mistake, please do let me know in the comments. I'm always happy to learn and unlearn. So let's start with one of the most important components, the CPU. CPU is said to be the brain of the computer, and it's kind of really important that we make the right decision when it comes to that. There are plenty of options to choose from, both from the Intel side of things and AMD side. So for example, let's take a look at the AMD Ryzen 3 1300X. So if you look at the AMD website or the Amazon listing, you can see in the descriptions or on the box, it says something like 4C8T. Now this 4C and 8T stands for 4 cores and 8 threads. These numbers in terms actually give us a lot of information about the CPU. In order to break these numbers in terms down, let's kind of briefly understand how a CPU works. So whatever we do on a computer is processed by the CPU. Like if you're making a mouse click to open a folder, the click gets converted into a process. And the process in turn is made up of a lot of tiny threads. And threads are the smallest set of instructions that a CPU can execute in one go. Now all these threads get to the CPU and the CPU executes them to show a result on the screen. Now in our case, it is the folder opening on the screen. We said a process is made up of a lot of tiny threads, but we don't feel all these threads getting executed one by one because a processor can execute almost a billion threads in a second. In the 90s and early 2000s, almost all the consumer grade CPUs were single core and single threaded. That is 1C and 1T. These CPUs could only receive one thread at a time, and they were not really that good at multitasking either. If you were multitasking on a single core single thread CPU, the operating system would schedule the threads from all of the programs you're running in such a way that it reaches the CPU one after the other. Like imagine you were browsing the internet and you have a song playing in the background. So first a thread from the browser will get executed, and then one from the music player, and then again another one from the browser, and then again the music player, and this cycle goes on. Again, we can't see this happening or we can't feel this happening because, like we said, processor can execute over a billion threads in a second. And in 2002, Intel introduced their concept of hyperthreading. Now all of a sudden, a hyperthreaded single core CPU started acting like a dual core CPU. Hyperthreading allowed the CPU to make virtual cores. So even if the CPU had only one physical core, hyperthreaded CPUs could kind of trick the operating system into thinking that there were two cores. Think of it like a supermarket with a single billing line and an exit. There is a man standing at the exit to double check your bill before you leave. No matter how many customers go to him at once, this man can only check one bill at a time. Now in computer terms, this is like a one core, one thread setup. The customers are the threads and the man standing at the exit is the core. Coming back to the supermarket example, if for some reason there is a delay in the counter, the customers will also take longer time to reach this person. Then the man would be just standing there doing nothing. He would be, let's say, in an idle state, which also happens inside a CPU. The CPU might have finished executing a bunch of threads and would be waiting for a new set of threads to reach it, which in computer terms is not an efficient way of working. Again, going back to the supermarket example, imagine if the owners decide to set up one more counter. This means there are now two lines with a steady stream of customers coming to this person. If one line gets delayed, there is always a customer coming from the second line towards the man. So now the man is working non-stop, or in computer terms, efficiently. But imagine if both the lines started moving smoothly. Now that would create another line of angry customers in front of this man. So ideally, what the supermarket owners should have done from the beginning is hire one more man for the job, because while delays are not a common thing, there will always be days or even hours when there is a huge rush of customers coming into the store. When that happens, this man alone won't be able to handle the crowd. This is why, while hyperthreaded CPUs are a huge lifesaver, they can never replace dedicated physical cores on a CPU. Now that you have an idea of how a CPU works and what threads and cores are, let's get into some recommendations based on your use case scenarios. For basic use such as web browsing, Netflix, online classes, YouTube, things like that, you can technically still use a single core CPU. But these days, those things are really rare, and I don't think even smartphones use single core CPUs these days. If you go to Intel and AMD website and check for a CPU which fits this kind of a use case, Intel suggests that you go with their Celeron and Pentium ranges, while AMD suggests their Athlon series. But in my opinion, only go for these CPUs if you are on a very tight budget. Otherwise, try to get at least Intel i3 processors or AMD Ryzen 3 processors. They offer you a better value for the money and also a little bit more performance. One thing to make sure if you're buying an AMD processor is that you go for something with integrated graphics in it, or you'll have to find a motherboard which supports integrated graphics. All the AMD processors ending with an X in their name does not come with integrated graphics, which means you will have to get a dedicated graphics card, or like I said, have to find a motherboard with integrated graphics support. When it comes to Intel though, almost all Intel CPUs do come with integrated graphics, but just to be sure, it's always safe to make sure that you are getting a CPU with integrated graphics on it if you're not planning to run a dedicated GPU. If you're in the market for a laptop, you don't have to worry about that, because almost all laptops do come with either a dedicated GPU or an integrated GPU. And if you're building a system for your home and you think you might get into light gaming or try your hands at some Adobe products like Photoshop Premiere or something like that, then going a step up and getting the Intel i5 series or the Ryzen 5 series would be a better option. While Ryzen 5 series CPUs are a better value for money, when it comes to gaming, Intel CPUs are still considered better for gaming performance. Now, if you're already into gaming and you're sure that you're going to use softwares like Premiere, After Effects or DaVinci, Photoshop, all of that, then you can go for the Intel i7 series processors or the Ryzen 7. And if you're a high-end user working with 4K videos and 3D renders and things like that, you can go all the way up and get the Intel i9 series or the Ryzen 9 series. Now, I know there are bigger processors from both Intel and AMD, like the Xeon series or the Threadripper series. We're not discussing those on this video. And in my personal experience, when it comes to softwares like Premiere Pro, After Effects or DaVinci Resolve, AMD has an edge over Intel at this point, and AMD CPUs are a better value for money if you're a content creator. We'll be leaving a link in the description where you can find software related benchmarks for all these different CPUs. So if you are a content creator, or like we said, somebody who works with all these creator softwares, you can always take a look at that before making a purchase decision. Also, if you need any help in deciding what to get, please do let us know in the comments or send us a message on Instagram. And with that, we are wrapping up this video, and the next video in the series in which we will be talking about RAMs will be up soon. If you like the content, do give the video a thumbs up and consider subscribing to the channel. This is Ajish, and thank you for watching TechSafe.